One of my friends used to say, speed is the spirit of the slopes. Of course, he doesn't want to call for skiing recklessly. It's more about the essence of skiing, which is how we deal with the speed and momentum. In other words, skiing is pure physics. When skiing, we play with energy, momentum, speed, directions, force, and pressure. We can convert them into each other, but the equation always has the same result. You can use your energy to accelerate or change the direction. You can slow down the speed of the ski or your body, but the price you pay for braking is the bigger force you must withstand. Learning to ski and developing ski techniques is actually how not to screw up what physics can do perfectly. Whether we fight against or cooperate with the forces is not the same. So, the skier must be in motion to ski. The mass in motion is actually the physical phenomenon of momentum. So, first let's review some basic information about how physics makes skiing. Momentum is how fast an object is moving. So, skiing means managing our energy, the momentum, in a stable, safe and fun way, with possibly less braking. Speed, and therefore also linear momentum, has not only magnitude, but also direction. And the direction is as important as the magnitude. This direction is always straight, so we cannot have a circular or curved momentum. An external influence can make us move in a new direction, but this change of direction lasts only until the external force exists. When the external force stops acting on us, we will move in a straight line again. Every body part of a skier, including the ski itself, has its own momentum. This is one reason why sometimes skiers' arms fly back and forth, we can feel a bad twist or spin of the shoulders, a slalom racer falls with a backflip, and the skis fly away after a fall. Actually, in extreme cases, the ski can ski alone after the ski loses it. For simplicity, we used to speak about only two main parts, the center of mass and the ski. But we shouldn't forget that the center of mass is a non-existent theoretical representation of the whole body. We do not have a body part called center of mass. This simplification helps to understand some concepts, but it can turn into oversimplification, which can be misleading at other times. On the ski slopes, there is a primary momentum with a permanent direction created by gravity. An object on the slope may have a lateral momentum across the hill, but it will run out after a while, and this direction will turn towards the fall line. It's like rolling a ball across the slope. After a while, it will roll down in a fall line. So moving down along the fall line is an ever-present factor, and the ski can temporarily force the skier out of it. Turning is a temporary compulsion, but the main direction of an object on a slope is the fall line. One of the biggest game changers is getting used to moving in a curved line across the slope with a decent speed, or in other words, converting the downhill speed into travel speed. How can we turn if the momentum is a motion in a straight line? The thing is that the skier cannot turn. Only the ski can turn until it has a certain edge grip. All the other parts, including the body's theoretical representation, the center of mass, travel straight. They follow the turn only because they are more or less stably connected to the ski. This connection is constructed from bones and joints, ankle, knee, hip joint, and the spine, and is actively stabilized by muscles. This construction consists of many planes: the ski and feet, the lower leg, the femur, the pelvis lumbar spine, and the upper body. Each can move or rotate more or less freely in relation to the other. When the skier disconnects to some extent their ski from other body parts, the ski will continue to turn, but the disconnected parts will not exactly follow the ski anymore. They will move more or less in the direction of their last momentum. Such a release of each joint helps to happen the transition. The turn phase, the timing in which the release happens, and the way how it happens has a decisive effect on the next turn's inclination and shape. It's also important to mention that turning means moving along a curved path, not turning the body around its longitudinal axis like twisting. Let's see how all this works in the different turn phases. During the transition, the skis lie on the base, they don't have any edge grip. Therefore, the ski cannot turn. Every part of the skier moves in the direction of their momentum from the last part of the completion phase. The skis run more to the side across the slope, and the body moves more downhill closer to the foreline. This deviation of the two directions establishes the edge angle and the inclination of the next turn. This can be felt as an unbalanced situation as we start falling over the skis. But the first mistake a skier can make is to avoid it and try to regain balance. We have to take this unbalanced phase to win a stable turn. A balanced transition will result in an uncontrolled turn. Regarding the turn shape, the initiation is the opening part of the crescent moon. The skis travel more across the slope and the body more downhill. The distance between the ski and the body increases, creating the edge angle. The edge angle creates lateral force that pushes the ski into the new turn. However, the pressure is not significant because the distance between the ski and the body increases continuously during this phase. So the ski can only push the body to a limited extent. It's also an unbalanced phase which needs some courage. The skier feels that the ski is moving away from them. That's why most skiers try to cheat by not letting the ski travel so far to the side, turning the ski, making a step movement, or jumping this phase over. However, cheating in this phase will distort the turn shape, resulting in sliding, unnecessary braking, and weaker edge grip. At the apex, the skis and the body's directions are similar, both travel downhill near the foreline. This is where the ski gets the biggest lateral force impact and the radius is the shortest. The skier is in an ideal postural situation to transfer the lateral effect to the body, so theoretically the peak pressure on the ski can be expected here. It's a pretty familiar situation because the directions are similar and it's easy to coordinate the different parts. Many skiers believe that they will be too fast in the foreline, so they try to get over it as quickly as possible by turning their skis across. However, acceleration in the foreline isn't the biggest challenge in skiing, especially not because we cannot spend enough time in the foreline to reach a too high speed. The completion, the second closing part of the crescent moon shape. The skis continues to turn across the slope, and the rest of the body travels near the foreline. The body approaches the skis, and this is the first time that the skis are under the body regarding the slopes. Because the body travels downhill, but the skis are already across, we can feel we will trip over the skis or the skis jump out to the side. That's why many skiers slow down the body, the ski, or both. If the body or the ski stops or begins to slide, it seems easier to coordinate the movements, but it is an illusion. The ski is only stable until it has an ideal speed. It is challenging but possible to control when it's too fast. But when it stops, it loses stability. On the other hand, stopping the body and the ski creates an unnecessary big load on the ski and the exact moment when they slow down. So this phase offers an excellent opportunity to prepare for a perfect transition and initiation, but it's also a high-level coordination challenge. Each plane of the body begins to act differently, and our mind has to coordinate all the different planes, movements, and directions in a short time frame. The completion phase offers endless possibilities, each of them resulting in a different next turn. This is the most decisive phase regarding the shape of the next turn, but it can also pose serious challenges. So we're gonna look at the three main scenarios, the Maverick, the Reasonable, and the Mr. Play It Safe. The Maverick has high level coordination, can release early, and doesn't care where the skis will run. They let the body rush directly down over the skis and can build precise anticipatory muscle tension. Those guys tend to use a cross-under transition, often with flexion. They won't experience a big pressure on the skis because the body can flow over the skis without acceleration. A typical everyday skier will use the opportunity given by the skis located below the body and push the body uphill to change the body path closer to the skis path. With this adaptation, the path of the body and the ski will be more similar, making prediction and movement coordination easier. In this case, they will feel more pressure from the skis at the completion than at the apex. The price that has to be paid for this relief is the delay in the transition, a more flat shape of the next turn, and a later edge angle. With all that, it's a reasonable, safe way of skiing for an everyday skier. Mr. Play It Safe is not prepared for any loss of balance or to coordinate different directions and movements of different body parts. So they try to reduce their momentum and bring the different directions closer to each other. There are two options, slowing down the body or slowing down the ski to modify the pathways instead of adapting the situation. Because the skis are located under the body, it's easy to slow down the body, making the skis and the body pass parallel. The most obvious way is to stop the ski across motion by blocking it with braking and sliding. The body and the ski will travel down here together, which seems simpler to coordinate. After that, both can move together across the slope, making a traverse instead of a transition. From a traverse, there is no chance for a proper transition. The next turn will be wrong for sure. Looking at all the stages, we can see that each stage has consequences for the other. They cannot be treated separately. That's why we suggest to starting a run from a straight gliding in a full line with a half turn, with a completion, because this is the most decisive phase. Learning to ski is more than knowing some skiing movements. It's pretty easy to learn the most essential movements and techniques. However, a big part of skiing learning curve is learning to manage the different directions, multitask, and develop spatial orientation. If you enjoy this content, please support our works with a super thanks. If you have any questions, don't hesitate to ask in the comments or here on the ski slopes in person. See you soon!